welcome to our second session. You're 24 hours into the summit so far. I hope this has been valuable, both in terms of the messages you've heard in the various meetings you've gone to, the boardrooms, and we'll hopefully continue that trajectory. I appreciate the fact that you had some time to continue to network with the people at your table. We think that's an important and valuable component of this summit as well. So today we're going to talk about resiliency and integrity. We have another great group of panelists and discussion slated for today. Before we introduce our first two in-person panelists, I do want to have Mike Moore introduce himself. You got a sneak peek. He kind of had a cameo appearance at the end of yesterday's panel. But let me have Mike introduce himself.
Well, hello. Welcome. Welcome to the Housing Transformation Summit. The fact that you're here makes you better and different than the majority of people who didn't show.
It's a good sales.
Because you're out trying to improve. And my name is Mike Moore. I have spent most of my life trying to help people improve, and specifically our building industry, keep challenging it to improve. Came out of the personalization process from floor covering as a vendor to the interior design to new home sales and leadership, and have been working for 25 to 28 years on online sales for personalization and new home sales, and have been preaching a message that's new versus used for many years. 1996 was the first time I stated that we now sell a fashion item. The home as a fashion item. It's about lifestyle. It's about living experience. So that's, you know, where I come from and who I am and why it matters to me that you're here and that you are. I'm proud of the fact there's a lot of great leaders in our industry that are stirring that pot now and trying to take that next step with digital transformation. But let's look at the product and let's look at what we do and how we think. And are we really selling the newest, best home we can build so that we can elevate lifestyles and improve people's living experience? That's mine. That's where I come from.
Okay, our next panelist you got to hear from yesterday, but I'll have him introduce himself again. Eric.
Good morning. My name is Eric Delansky. I'm a marketing professor from Brock University in Canada. I teach courses in marketing. I also specifically teach courses in pricing, which is what I'm here to talk to you about today. Some of you would have seen me yesterday, as Brandon said. And really the message that I'm trying to impart to all of you while I'm here is the idea of pricing based on value rather than pricing based only on cost, because cost doesn't necessarily represent what the customer is willing to pay for a particular product or element of the home. So that's what I'm here to talk about today.
Excellent. And our last panelist, Ryan.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ryan Lush. I'm the Chief Technology Officer for S2A Modular. We're a modular company, obviously. That's why we got the word in there. Modular company, build houses out of factories. Everybody knows what modular building is. I do a lot of the technology stuff, really involved in renewable energy, sustainability, a lot of cutting edge things. I'll talk about a few things that we're doing, and I'm the resident geek of the company, so I talk about all the geeky stuff.
Well, to start off today, the topic, I could probably go through and like read what we have in the booklet, but we're focusing on resiliency and integrity. And so I think the first question that I want to pose, particularly to Ryan, is, you know, what is resiliency and integrity? Why is it important to home building? We heard some mentions of it yesterday from Nick talking about resiliency being that if you get cut off from the grid, that your home can still function. But I don't think that's the whole thing. So is there anything you want to add specifically to what is resiliency and integrity, and why is it important to us today as we're trying to sell new homes?
I look at it really holistically, personally, and I think everybody's starting to get there as well, because I've been talking to everybody throughout just the last day and, you know, back in other conferences. So holistically, you know, resiliency means a lot of different things, but it's no secret to everybody. Whether you want to believe the climate and the environment is the reason we've had some, you know, pretty disastrous things happen, things that just recently happened in Florida. I mean, even back to Katrina, right? whether you believe that or not, the fact of the matter is we're finding out when these things happen that the houses that were built years ago just can't handle it, and they're not going to last. And so I think we've all been kind of forced to the fire to say, what can we do better? Let's look at these things. We see codes, right, getting beefed up in areas. And, you know, as you guys all know, you know, being involved, it's, you know, if you can build in Dade County right now, you can build anywhere. So if you make that kind of like your poster child place to look at right now, don't try and meet that, exceed it, because it's not going to stay there. Those codes are going to get enhanced. We're going to have more, again, whether you believe it, whether it's climate and climate change or whatever, we're going to keep having these disasters, and we're just going to keep learning. So the resiliency and the build and the strength of home, those are the things we're really looking at, and the integrity. Resiliency as far as power and staying on, different aspect, but it is holistic when we talk about resiliency, right? It is everything. It's not just the fact that you can have millimeter cut tolerances and, you know, advanced enclosures is all great, but that's a small piece. I think it's just one piece of the holistic. So that's you know, how we look at it.
So we've got wind, for instance. We got water, both coming from the air or building up from the ground. We've got temperatures, both cold and extreme heat. Fire, I know growing up in Southern California, you know, how they build there to be able to withstand if there's a wildfire coming up close to the house, how do you make sure that it's going to be okay afterwards, not catch on fire? So there's a lot of different aspects of this. I'm curious with our group here, who has to build with some pretty extreme resiliency issues? Anyone want to share what you have to build to? We'll get a microphone out to you here, and I'm catching our AV team early in the process here. I told them I was going to keep them on their toes. So Katie, Ryder, if you raise your hand so she can see where you're at.
Speaking of, we build to Miami-Dade because we're in Naples, Florida.
Right.
And almost all of our homes are impact glass standard. You know, they've got to have 180 mile an hour wind rating standard. And we do a lot of high performance things as well. But as far as code requirements, it's Miami-Dade.
Yeah. Other extreme areas in here that you want to share or brag about that you have to build to? I mean, I live in, you know, Kansas, so Tornado Alley is certainly our thing. We had one touchdown in our city just back a couple months ago. All right, well, we're going to talk a little bit more about this. So Ryan, talk to us a little bit about what are some of the advantages of the new materials and design that are in the market today that can help address some of these challenges and issues.
Well, if we all know this, that, you know, I think part of everything that we're doing is an acknowledgement. We're probably the biggest offenders in embodied carbons, and, you know, we don't the building industry isn't real nice towards the environment and the climate. So we've looked at everything from, you know, transportation, we're changing that, and manufacturing and all the things, but at a core, we're looking at the actual building materials. So we've spent a lot of time in research and development, and we've been doing, we got a new arm of our company called Organic Creation. So we are not chopping down trees anymore. We're not using lumber. It's more expensive. We're using plant-based building materials, even dimensionals, 2x4s, 2x6s. We don't use drywall. We use something called, we're calling it a green board. These things got a lot of benefits, and it's a lot more expensive. A lot of people think it's just going to be this huge cost. It's not. It's, you know, when you look at plant-based, it's a lot less cost to chop down fields of plants than it is tearing down trees, wrecking the environment, doing all of those things. It's less cost, but it's also fire reflective. It doesn't dry rot. It doesn't mildew. You don't get termites. You can't, it actually absorbs CO2 when you start talking about health and wellness. And, you know, if you're going after things like well certifications, all these things come into play. So, you know, when, like for our instance, you know, we're a modular company. We already know FEMA recommends modular builds for disaster areas. Well, when we're starting to do things like this with different materials that add strength because they fossilize, they become stronger in time. Any structure we build with this material is going to be stronger in 10 years than it was the day it was built. So those kind of things.
Why is that? So explain that one more time.
It basically
gets stronger.
It becomes stone-like. Yeah, it's right at the off the start. It's already stronger, and we've done all of our R&D and our testing. Our certification's almost done for dimensional lumber and things like that, or dimensional material.
Yeah,
I still say lumber. It's not lumber. But yeah, it's just stronger, and it calcifies. It becomes stone-like, so it'll be stronger afterwards. And we've done all kinds of strength tests on it, and we have stuff to prove. And I mean, moving forward, we're fulfilling our needs and filling our warehouses right now for our jobs, but we are going to make these materials available if people would like to use them, because quite frankly, we spent a lot of years in R&D and a lot of money getting these things done. So we're not trying to hold the cure to cancer. You know, people want to use it, use it.
So similar to some of the issues we talked about yesterday, resiliency and integrity are somewhat invisible in a home, that it's not something that may seem as obvious to a home buyer. So the question then becomes, how do we sell that to the customer? And so the question I want to pose to Mike first, and then we'll go around the table here to kind of react to what he shares, is how can we better present or promote these concepts, these features at the sales center? So, Mike, what do you think?
You know, this is another one that I think is pre-sales center as much as it is sales center. Yes, again, we can demonstrate, we can leave some things open to show the differences, show how things have improved, how codes have improved the construction of a home. And you can leave some areas open and visible that are normally invisible and hidden, but pre-education, because the shoppers are. I mean, we're all buying online now for years. It was 28 years ago that I started challenging salespeople that if they didn't get better human skills and communication skills, technology would replace them. And the internet was then here and starting, and we knew it was going to make this impact as we look forward. But we need to use the internet now better to pre-educate and then demonstrate at the models, or at least signage again at the models, reminding people new versus used. It's this used premise hasn't even come up for very long. It's been resale homes. Even for new home builder agents, salespeople, executives, I can remember only a few years ago using the term used to an executive team and several of them thinking it sounded harsh. Don't you mean resale? No, if we're in the new home business, let's be proud that new homes are better than used homes and people would pay more. Remember, what we're trying to do with the housing transformation is sell the people we're not selling. We're going to keep selling. What I hear a lot from buyers or from salespeople and marketing people, well, buyers don't care about that. Well, the buyers who are buying from us now may not, but the 40% of the shopping market that we should be selling on top of what we're selling does care. They shop, then they go home and redecorate or remodel because they don't believe we're better. So we've got to start to differentiate and brag about new versus used and be proud of the fact that it is better and that there is a market of people who want to buy new that we're not selling because we haven't convinced them new is different. 15, 20 years ago, I started asking sales and purchasing both, what does your house do today that the house you built 5 years ago didn't do for me? And it was hard for them to explain anything. So I would pose that always as a question for builders to check themselves. Forget about used and older homes. How does the home you build today, how does it impact my life in a positive way as an owner more than the home you built 5 years ago? Because it better be better so that you give me a reason to sell my five-year-old home and buy yours, and you will sell more homes for more money and more profit.
So I think one concept in there kind of resonated with me is making some of those invisible things visible in your demos, and whether that means, you know, trying to show off what's behind the drywall. How many of you are doing something like that in your show homes where you're making it so that the customers can see what's behind there and why it's different and how it's being constructed? So I think that's important to let them visualize so they know what the bones are in the new home they're about to buy. What are some other thoughts or reactions from either of you? Go ahead.
Sure. In terms of making invisible things visible, what you were talking about before and what we were talking about with codes, okay? Most customers aren't necessarily going to know what the codes are and how strong the house needs to be and what type of glass needs to be used. So you can use that as a selling point to add value to your home to say, this home will withstand up to 180 mile an hour winds or whatever else, as selling it as a value add, even though you know you got to do this anyway. And selling that, to use the phrase that was said a couple times yesterday, selling that peace of mind. That, you know, you can't promise them that a hurricane won't come and knock their house down, but you can promise them you've got this house that's built to withstand up to a certain amount of force. So making that element that you might take for granted as something you have to do into something that will add value to the customer can be extremely valuable to yourself as well in terms of the prices you can charge.
Yeah, I'd echo also from experience what Mike was saying. I think for us, and I was the chief sales officer before I became chief technology officer, and I've done sales for a lot of years and ran a lot of teams. But as we all know, you know, the human psyche, the logic and emotion never occupy the same brain. So when you're looking at it, it's a know your audience type of thing, right? There's some people that are buying homes and there's some people that are investing in homes. And that doesn't mean you're investing to get an ROI later. You're just investing because it's a great place for my kid to grow up. Or it's this, or it's that. So I think for us, we're always trying to identify that logic person and that emotion person because it's two different sales types. So the education incline is always going to be there, especially as we're transforming. It's going to be there inherently. But identifying our audience has been the best thing for us because some people, frankly, don't give two hoots about the environment. They're like dollars, integrity, resilience. And some people are like, okay, it's gonna withstand stuff, I'm not codes, but you know, what kind of materials are you using? We get them both. So knowing the audience for us has been a big advantage, especially the last year and a half. That's what we really noticed, is really identify who you're talking to, because that's made a world of difference for us. And the ones that are savvy, your salespeople that are out there that have every tool in their tool bag and know when to pull out which tool for which audience, those are the ones, it's no secret, those are the ones that are closing way more.
Makes sense. So your research focuses in this area. Can you tell us, Eric, what are some of the findings you've seen when it comes to the value perceived by the customer and how you can influence or create those perceptions?
I'm going to use one example from sustainability, which isn't my own research, but it's research I've used in some of my own work. You all are familiar with like products that you buy at the grocery store to clean your home that might be green, right? That might be certified as environmentally friendly. The research shows it's not just that you can get away with charging more for a product like that. The research shows that customers actually expect you to charge more and will not believe the product will perform as well if you don't charge more. So as an example, let's say I'm going to the store, I'm going to buy something to clean my windows. I can buy Windex or I can buy Greenworks window cleaner. If they're priced the same, I will assume the Greenworks doesn't get my windows as clean. If they price the Greenworks higher, then I might believe that, okay, it is environmentally friendly and it will get my windows as clean. And so this isn't just an opportunity. This is now baked in, at least for those customers you're talking about that care about this stuff, that this home is as advanced, as resilient, as strong, and it's environmentally friendly. They will have an expectation that it will be more. So if they're coming to you when you advertise your sustainability credentials, they're ready to pay more for this.
Yep.
What you see on the screen here, it's not about having the lowest price. It's about having a right price. So this is a very simple model I learned when I was in my MBA about pricing. Okay, so you've got value on the x-axis and you've got price on the y-axis. And this would represent a stable industry. It could be housing, it could be window cleaner, it could be whatever. And you see the different players on the line there, and as the value that the customer perceives goes up, the price that you charge goes up as well. And ideally, you want to be on that line because that line represents the relationship between price and value. The more you pay, the more value you get. If you go into a market, you price above that line, well, you're going to be in trouble because customers can get something of the same value for less money. If you price below that line, what you might be doing is starting a price war. That line gets less steep, and now every player in the industry now has to deliver so much more value just to get a little incremental amount more price. So you want to protect a good, steep curve like that. Now, I've talked to companies, not in housing and other industries, where we've done a simple analysis like this, and we showed them you're above the line. You either have to lower your price, or you have to demonstrate and communicate more value to get somewhere on that line. And demonstrating, communicating that value can come from lots of places. You might already be delivering it and just the customer doesn't believe you. Or it could be something simple you could do, you know, in terms of materials you're using that would be a relatively easy switch for you, but that might be very meaningful for the customer. But you want to know where you are on that line. You want to have a degree of control over how steep it is and make sure you're delivering the right price for the right value.
Thoughts?
Nailed it. The only thing I would say, you know, sometimes I use some smart-ass comments when I'm selling, and sometimes I just get right down to it, and I'll say, you know, you want to read? Do you want to read by candlelight, or you want to read by light bulb? If you're buying candles still, you need to know about the value of a light bulb. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's kind of what he's saying, is they just don't know sometimes. Explain it to them. They should know the difference between a candle and a light bulb, but that's not my point.
So I'm curious from the audience now, what are you thinking? Do you push back on this? Does this make sense? Do you feel like it just doesn't, it's hard to implement in the real world when the rubber hits the road? Anyone have any comments or questions from the audience? The one thing that pops to mind for me, and I understand this is and we have a question here in the front, someone would like to share. I get that we're talking about the largest purchase that people make, and so there's always a concern of price, but I know I look at probably the second largest purchase that people make in terms of cars, and I look at the price of SUVs like 20 years ago and what they are today, and it's like more than doubled, and at least for those that like to buy new things, they're more than happy to now be spending $90,000, $100,000 on an SUV. But it's not because it's the same SUV from 20 years ago. There's so many more features there.
It's not just that. We're going to come to your question. If you look at any car company, you know, you look at Toyota, you look at Mercedes, you look at whoever, they're doing this. Mercedes has, you know, 8 to 10 product lines, different sedans, different SUVs, and they price them up that line. So you go to the dealership and you can clearly see this is their representation of the value you get versus the price you pay. It's made extremely clear. And if you look across the industry, you look at Mercedes and BMW and Lexus, all their lines kind of align, right? They may not be exactly the same, but they all understand this is the story we're telling with regard to price.
Okay, here.
So this is going all the way back to the beginning of your presentation, but I was just curious about, you talked about the plant-based, not lumber, but I don't know what we want to call it. Plant-based sticks.
It's organic building materials.
Organic building materials. So I guess going back to that, you talked about that there's some research that you guys are still working on. I'm curious about where that stands today, because that's a new concept to me. And then also, where do these plant-based products come from? Is that coming from the USA? Is it coming from overseas? And then second part of that is with the different options of green board.
Yeah, I'll lift the hood a little bit just for anybody that's curious. So people grow a certain plant that we know about, and they care about the flower. They don't care about the fiber. They don't care about the herd, right? To build, there's a couple of different types. You want some for textiles, and you want some for industrial. You take that. They don't want it. Initially, they were paying us to haul it off. It was trash to them. But it's not trash when you put it under extreme heat, and you add a little thing or two to it, then you can mold it into whatever you want. So that's what we're doing, is just taking, and you can probably guess what I'm talking about, but it's that's what we're doing. And so when we started to come out with a few and put them through testing, they worked great, and everybody wanted to use them. So we're like, okay, we're at our company, we're like, we don't look at, you know, engineers build something, they go, here it is, you guys apply it. We're absolutely the opposite. We're like, no, how about this is the application we need. We need to apply this. Why don't you go back to the drawing board and give us what we want? Because we're the ones selling it. We're the one moving product. You're the one creating it, trying to dictate to us how to move it, how to sell it, how to use it. It shouldn't be that way. Do a complete paradigm shift. So that's what we're doing, is pushing those engineers, you know, BS, we need this. And so that's how we're getting to where we're getting. But you know, good or bad, COVID and a bear market right now gave us the ability to build instead of market and worry about profits and trying to grow 100%. It's a time to build. That's what we did. We just said, we do this and we come out smelling like a rose, or we don't, and we're status quo.
So most of that material can be found here in the U.S.?
Oh, yeah. Sorry, yeah. To that point. Mm-hmm. It's a weed, man. Grows anywhere.
That's the same with the drywall material?
Yeah, because it's all being sourced from the same
stuff.
Yeah, and like the green board, you know, there's amazing things we could talk more offline if you want to call it that. But you know, we can submerge that green board in water for weeks, does no damage. You hit it with an elbow, it doesn't put a dent in it. You know, everybody knows how fun putting drywall is and how careful you have to be. And you know, if you're on a site and you've been a general, you're yelling at everybody that's touching the drywall, right? Because you're gonna have so much left. Well, with this, it's much, much stronger, much more resilient, has all those benefits, absorbs CO2, it's stronger, all those things. So that's why we're moving to that. And you know, once we get our dimensional stuff done, we won't stop. There's always something else that could be done. I mean, it's crazy. With this material, you can make nails and screws out of it. It's that strong and it's insane. I mean, you can't do everything you want to do, but you can do a lot with it.
And what's currently the price comparison between green board and drywall?
So I need to be very careful on that currently, but it'll be out on our site really soon. But I can tell you this, it is significantly less.
Okay. Well, that's the answer we were looking for.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right. Moving on. Good. Any other questions from the audience before we kind of move on to the next topic? Okay, so we talked about the sales center. So now the question is, how can we better present or promote influence perceptions in our marketing assets? So as we look at our marketing assets, what are we doing as we're sharing to be able to influence those perceptions? So we'll toss that question to, I think, let me go to Mike first.
Sure.
And then, well, maybe I don't have Mike. I thought we had Mike, so I'll turn it to you. Go ahead.
Sure. So let's use this green board as an example.
Okay.
So you're saying that the price is much, much lower.
Yep, it's a better price.
Right. So what that does, some of you might have seen this image yesterday. What that does is it lowers that bottom line, that floor that you have to sell it at. What it does as well for certain customers anyway is it raises that ceiling because it will be of higher value because it is sustainably sourced, because it is stronger, because of all of those things. What that does is not only allow you to charge more if the value is higher, it gives you a wider range of prices that you can charge. Now, in order to do that, you have to measure and understand the value that you are presenting to the customer so you know where that ceiling is. And you don't want to price at that ceiling because what you're doing then is giving the customer a difficult decision to make between a higher priced green board and a lower priced drywall. Yes?
Does it have a better fire rating was the question. Yeah.
It's fire reflective. We have video 6,000 Fahrenheit for 7 hours straight and does less than 1/16th of damage. You just wipe the soot off. It's crazy. Yeah, it's wild.
Lots of value there. So you're looking for good opportunities like this. It might be the materials that you're using. It might be the features and benefits you're putting in the home. It might be that peace of mind that you're selling. But you're looking for those big ranges where you have lots of options for where you can price within that range and still make a good margin for yourself. You can also influence perceptions through things like bundling, okay? So you have that customer who cares about sustainability, who wants to buy this because it's sustainably sourced. What else can you sell in the home that is sustainably sourced and put it all together in one bundle under one price, not to make it cheaper, but to make it easier for the customer to say yes to that price? It's not bundling so you can discount these features. It's bundling because you know this customer cares about this and you want to give them one decision to make instead of 20 decisions to make where they might say yes to some and no to others. And highlighting those key features, you know, as Ryan was talking about, what does this customer care about? Let me sell that.
Is anyone having good experiences with bundling, creating bundles like that to make the decision easier for customers? I'm seeing some nods, so definitely seems to resonate.
And I think the next slide is me as well. Yeah.
Yes.
And the other thing you can do, and maybe you're doing this already, as I've said a thousand times already, I'm not a housing guy, so I'm not as familiar with your industry. I know the car industry does this. Having a map like this that you can give customers about, here's what we're doing, here's what the competitors are doing, here's what used is doing. This is what you get in a used house, this is what you get in a new house. The image I just pulled off the web, it's not housing, it's databases. And making sure that the one you create for your customers makes you look the best you can. Those key features along the top, you're hitting all of those, your competitors are not hitting all of those. You make this the version of this that best reflects you. Not only do you have a sales tool that shows we've got everything you want, you're also teaching the customer these are the features you should be looking for. This is what's important, those features along the top. If you're, if the other sellers don't have this, you're missing something. And so therefore, you can influence not just whether or not they pick you, but the reasons why they're picking you. And you can learn about your customers in terms of what they actually see as important out of that list through your sales conversations with them. Find those areas of concern. What do they think might be missing? What are they coming to you and asking, do you have this? And either get that or be able to explain to them why you don't have that, why it's not important. When I teach basic marketing components like positioning, like this is who we are and why you should choose our company, it's not just saying we're the best at it. It's also teaching them what this thing that we're the best at is the most important thing. And you'll see that successful marketing campaigns, whether for products, big products, little products, politicians, whatever else, that's what they do best. They say, this thing that we're best at, that's the most important thing. And for some customers, it'll be sustainability, and others, it'll be resiliency, and others, it'll be location, and others, it will be aesthetics. You know, and you have to make sure you're explaining to them, this is what we're best at, and that this is why it should matter.
So my eyes aren't as good as they used to be, and I know this isn't the housing specific, but, yeah. But let me just restate. Across the top, we would have different features. You can say, these are the things that are in our houses.
Yeah.
The rows would be, you know, perhaps the first row is a used house, and none of them are checked off because you don't get any of these things.
The first row should be you.
Okay, so first row should be you and say, here's all the things that we provide. Here's a used house, which is one alternative, and then
lots of
and then our competitors that are also selling new houses, they may do some of these things, but they're not doing these ones here, so you want to have...
Yeah.
Okay.
And not just hand it to the customer, but also explain, this is why each of those columns is important. This is why it's going to matter to you when you move into this home that that you have these features.
In terms of... either lifestyle experience they might get from it.
It
could be reduced total cost of ownership because of of it being envelope tight. It could be all of these
things. It could be when you're going to get the house, right? It could be how many times you're going to have to or you're going to want to visit the site before it's built. It could be anything that you see as both valuable to the customer and something you can do well.
Any other reaction?
Yeah, no, this is awesome. And it totally echoes exactly what I was kind of saying, how we look at it with, we just call it KYA, right? Know your audience. This is how you get to know your audience right here. Mm-hmm. That's it. I mean, we have a lot of sessions where we just talk about this all the time. If you don't know your audience, why are you even trying to talk to them? Mm-hmm. What are you talking to them about? You don't know anything they're wanting, right? So this is really important. I love this.
So, by show of hands, how many of you have something like this already on your website that's kind of at least highlighting? So we've got over here. Okay, so this is an opportunity.
Yeah, and Brandon, if I might. So years and years ago, not that I'm that much more knowledgeable about cars now, you know, you go to a dealership, they have stuff like this. They'll say this model has this, this model doesn't have this. They may not have the competitors on there, but they'll have this kind of grid. They have it on their website. And when I went to go buy my first car, I remember asking them about one of the columns, what is this? It was some technical automotive thing that I still don't understand. But by asking that question, they know, okay, this guy doesn't know anything about cars. He's not looking for, you know, performance features or engine features. He's probably looking at comfort, aesthetics, bells and whistles, that kind of stuff, and gets back to knowing your audience through what are they asking about this. So when they see a column and they say, what is green board? I don't understand. You look at that and you say, okay, here's an opportunity.
Yep. And I would imagine by leveraging digital assets for marketing, mm-hmm. which I know a lot of salespeople used to have just the pamphlets,
paper.
Right?
Yeah.
The paper that I've seen a lot of companies in various industries now moving to, you know, an iPad, and it's kind of choose your own adventure that as soon as they start probing and asking those questions, they can actually take a different branch of the presentation that's now going to have slides and features and things that cater to that particular demographic mm-hmm. that's going to help progress the sale. Yeah. So kind of moving on to the marketing assets, this is what I kind of jumped to before. Here's kind of Mike's thoughts on what we can do to better influence perceptions in our marketing assets.
Let me add this. And, you know, this really plays for structures, integrity, resilience, water efficiency, healthy, kind of plays for everything about this new versus used message. But if you think of a new home like a person, and you think of it as healthy, fit, and fashionable. If you're thinking of you as a person, you can be healthy and not fit and need to get in shape, okay? Let's think of healthy as the, everything from the bones, the structure, the health things, and build tight, ventilate that we're gonna be talking about. But if you think about healthy, and then you think, okay, but I'm not fit. Fits the technology that goes into the home, that makes the home run and work like it's supposed to. So I'm healthy, I'm not fit, I don't work right. If I'm fit, now for a home, the analogy is, it is all connected. It does work the way it's supposed to work and efficiently, and it's connected to me to run my home. And then fashionable is that design, personalization, that end of it. Because if I'm healthy and fit and I dress like a slob, I'm not going to be very attractive and not going to be at my best. But if I'm healthy, fit, and fashionable, now I am going to live my best life. As well as if it's the home analogy, healthy, fit, and fashionable means that that home is going to be most attractive because it will elevate my lifestyle and improve my living experience. And that will sell for more money, and that will sell in any marketplace because it will sell to people who are looking not just for housing, but that are looking to improve their life. And that's a big majority that are out there. And it's the people with money and credit, even in a down market, that will be the ones that will be attracted to a healthy, fit, and fashionable home.
Reactions?
I feel personally attacked because I'm not healthy, fit, or fashionable.
And I think Mike talked about this yesterday in his little cameo appearance, is that our salespeople sometimes may not be ones that are buying new homes themselves, and so their mindset is more geared towards what it shouldn't be. And so trying to make sure that we're going to get to talking about how we can better arm our salespeople is that maybe they can't empathize as much with their potential customer because they're not in that same position. I don't know. Thoughts?
With our marketing assets, I'm heavily involved in like blockchain, and we build video games and we do experiences in the metaverse and all that stuff already. So my knowledge of that, and knowing that Gen Z's here and that they call the next one the Gen Alpha, they're coming, everything needs to be their idea. And from sales, in my experience, I've always done a lot better when I've always made everything as like it was their idea. They decided to buy this off of me because I laid it out right to them. That's how we look at with the marketing assets. If I never have to talk to a customer and they bought, that's huge, huge, meaning your assets, your marketing assets were correct. You hit the point. So we look at that. That's how we're doing our perceptions of it is, what if we never had to say a word to them and they bought?
And what you're saying is with Gen Z and the next generation is that they're inclined and kind of prefer to do a sales experience without talking to someone in person.
They don't want to talk to us. They want to go to TikTok and buy stuff.
So are we ready for this? Are we ready for buyers who don't want to talk to us, who just want to be able to do everything online?
Better get used to it. That's how they buy. Everything. That's how they buy everything. They want to immerse. And they want to engage, but they want to do it on their own terms. They don't want to hear from you. They don't want to be sold anything.
And if they do have to talk to you, if they do have to talk to you, they will have done all of their research. Not necessarily good research, right. But they will have done what they believe to be the right research before coming to talk to you.
They'll come to us with exactly what they need to put ink to paper. They've already made up their own mind. So your marketing assets better be pretty damn good, because they're going to make up their mind without you. We're not going to be selling people anymore. We're going to be educating them, but we're not going to be selling them.
How many of you, by show of hands, feel like you're ready for that type of customer? Just happened to you 2 days ago. Okay.
Really. Yeah. She just wanted to know what she needed to sign and how she could pay.
Already had made up the mind before she'd come into the home.
Yep.
We've got a bit of time, so just walk us through what this was like.
Yeah, I'm interested. I want to hear this because we dealt with it a lot.
It's not that interesting of a story, really. I feel like dumb luck follows me around sometimes. So this buyer found we have an almost completed inventory home, and she did all of her research through realtor.com, looked at all the pictures that we had on there. We had just updated the description to be very accurate and current with the state of that home, that, you know, it's 3 weeks from move in or whatever the details were. She just needed inside, like at that moment. She said, "I'm here," you know, and this is a custom home kind of in a rural area. She said, "I'm here. How do I get in?" So I was literally boarding the plane to come here, was able to get somebody, one of our partners, to drive across town, open it. She walked in and said, "Okay, great. How do I pay the deposit?"
And what was the approximate age of this customer? Is it fit the Gen Z, or is it a very...
I guess this would be millennial. Millennial, yeah, yeah. Google executive in Austin. So
it's coming.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're going to see it more often. And so when we talk about marketing assets is trying to prepare a way to be able to make it more frictionless for customers who want to have that type of experience, to have that experience, because if they can't find the information they're looking for online, they may call you, or else they're just going to look to the next house, the next.
Yeah, place. We're not in a place yet where we need to abandon Web 2, because everybody still needs Web 2. They need web access to things. They need access, marketing assets, knowledge, education, all through a Web 2 environment. But the things that are happening in Web 3, if you guys aren't knowing what that technically means, which a lot of people don't, you got to start looking into it, or you're going to get smoked by the people that are in Web 3.
How would you describe the difference between Web 2 and Web 3?
Web 3 is immersive. Web 3 is not what Web 2 is. If you look at Web 2, I go to a website, it's like a billboard, and I have some options to click on certain things to get info or to reach out to you. Web 3 is I'm in it. I'm seeing it, I'm touching it, I'm smelling it, I'm feeling it, I'm doing everything on my own without you.
So I can give an example. I did some research recently on MAC Cosmetics, so makeup. They increased their conversion rate by over 100% through mobile for mobile sales, just by having not just pop-ups. Pop-ups are annoying, but they popped up stories and immersive content where, depending on what you clicked on, it would give you not information about the product, but information about someone who used the product and their story, which is engaging and draws them in, and then gives them another reason to buy. And so what the way you're describing Web 2 is click here for more information, and maybe you have a little blurb about this person. This is, no, you're looking at this product, we're going to tell you this story. You can close it if you want. We're going to tell you the story. And their conversion rate when they used that was increased by 113%.
And here's something a lot of people aren't going to want to know but face at some point. Influencers and celebrity endorsers are going to be our future. They're going to want to be, when we're talking about immersive means they want to hear Kim Kardashian tell us how cool the house is.
Not just Kim Kardashian, because so my wife is interested in home design and interior design, that stuff. It's not her career. It's not anything she's trained in. It's just when she goes onto Instagram, that's what she likes to look at. And so she's looking at influencers. Mm-hmm. I've never heard of these people. They aren't Kim Kardashian. They're people who have made their name entirely on Instagram and TikTok.
Yep.
Just doing this, posting little videos, little clips that I personally find tremendously annoying. But my wife loves it, and she eats it up, and then she's like, "Oh, we got to get one of these baskets. I saw it in the video and all that." And it's because she saw it on Instagram, not because she was looking for that type of product in the first place.
It's well said. Good. Give you another example, not to do with housing. We have a sports video game that we've got out now on mobile, and we released. We got a guy, it's a billiards game, playing pool, and he's an influencer on TikTok. The guy's got 2.5 million people, and he came to us with a healthy price tag, and he said, "Let me show you for a week how many downloads you'll get. You don't pay me anything. You get 6 days." Of course we paid him. It's insane. How big influencers and celebrity endorsements, but you said influencers are going to be the way we market. So when we're talking about perceptions of marketing assets, I'm not saying we're going to abandon Web 2 right now. We're years away from it. But if we're not doing Web 3, the older Gen Z gets, the older Gen Alpha gets, we're going to have kids that are playing video games, making income and a lot of money at the age of 14 to 15 years old, and they will be able to afford houses. They will be off of playing video games. Mm-hmm. That's what's coming.
You know about the TikTok shop?
Yep.
Yeah. So if you don't know, TikTok is taking steps to open an online store for their influencers to be able to sell stuff. And it's not just the online store. They're starting to build a network of warehouses and logistics across the country. Their intention is to rival Amazon.
Yep.
Whether that will come to fruition in terms of the scope that they're looking at or not,
I believe
who knows? But that's the way they want people to be able to watch TikTok videos and with one click buy the product, and TikTok will ship it to them.
I believe it will. I'll tell you why. My daughter's 24 years old. She's got a girl she played softball with in college, a couple years younger. Girl makes over 5 digits a month curling her hair and flattening her hair on videos. She's influencing millions of people to buy curling irons. And those companies are sending her free product and paying her 5 digits a month.
And soon they'll be able to just say, I'm going to buy this.
She's been doing this since she was 16 years old.
Yeah.
She's been making that kind of money since she was 16. She's 21 now. Her dad came to me and he's like, dude, what is my kid doing? I'm like, I don't know, buddy. I'm not going to say she's doing anything bad. But he's wondering. He's worried. He's like, how the hell is she making all this money? That's how she's making it. They're big influencers. They're going to market things.
So before we all get too anxious about this,
yes.
Let's talk about some positive things about this trend is that where before we may have been spending $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 on very pre-produced videos for our products, what I've seen in other industries now is that the customers that want this immersive experience, they don't want the pre-produced video. They literally want the selfie video like this, walking around the house, because it's more authentic. Is that the case with this as well?
Very true. I could just keep going on and on because I'm in this, but I got a friend, he's a tattoo artist. He's got over 1 million followers just on Facebook. His most popular videos are him and his kid walking the dog. And he's talking about a tattoo he did while he's walking his dog with his kid. That does like 10x. It's organic. That's what it is.
So the benefit is the cost to produce this type of content is dramatically less if you're doing it yourself or you're bringing in an intern who understands that generation. It's not the old set up all the lights and fancy. It's literally an iPhone doing a lot of the video.
Not to get too far off topic from resilience.
Yeah,
we've integrity,
totally but, right, yes. But it's good.
Sorry.
But it has to be authentic.
Yep.
It's the authenticity that sells it. If it seems like a sales pitch, if it seems artificial, it will get rejected. Absolutely 100%. It has to be real. That's what they're looking for. Like you said, the guy walking his dog, it's because they're not thinking this guy staged this video so that he could post it and get all these followers. It's just he posted a nice video of him and his son walking the dog, and they want to see real. They want to see authentic.
Okay, so how do we go and actually equip our sales team to deal with this changing and evolving landscape when it comes to selling to new generations? So let's ask Mike for his thoughts.
You know, the integrity of your home, the quality of construction, the quality of the products in your home have to be demonstrated. You brag about them, you set the stage online, but for salespeople, when was the last time you jumped in the tub and were able to jump up and down in the tub, show them how solid it was, or bang on the side of it and show them that yours is solid and better? Okay. When was the last time you were able to walk them through construction and show them how the construction, how well it's done, and how much you manage that construction so that the home is built better? The misconception in the marketplace, and one of my bankers actually was buying a new home from a customer of mine and said to me, my 30-year-old home, I hate to give it up. It's just built so well. And no one had explained to him how different his new home was. So we sat down, I did, with him for 10 minutes and just went over how the home is built the energy efficiencies, the healthy, the quiet, the wrap of the house, the insulation of the house, how it's inspected, what happens today. And I'm in California, it was under a new code, and from a builder that I know does it right and has for years and builds ahead of code. So when we were done, I was able to look at him and go, do you now understand that it's a misconception that they used to be built better? We don't build them like we used to. No, we build them better today, and we don't brag about it enough. Now, if you're a used home buyer, that's okay. Used home buyers are the people who want to live in an older community, grown in vegetation, all of that. If that's what you like for lifestyle, that's the lifestyle you buy. But the buyers we're missing are new home buyers who live in those communities now, want to move to a new community, but they don't believe our home is better. And that's shame on us that we're not marketing, advertising, and then sales presenting the fact that we have a superior product to what we had years ago. Now, be careful purchasing and operations that in this kind of market, you're not cutting corners to save money and build the house cheaper, and now we can't brag about it. If you build a better house, you can sell it to the people who have money, have credit, don't mind the interest rate because they will refi later, but you got to build a better house. So keep building a better product that gives me a better living experience and lifestyle. We stop and celebrate closing. Shame on us. We should celebrate the life our buyers live in their home. And we need to be bragging about the life that they are going to lead in their home and how all these things, the safety, the healthy, the efficient, the technology, how all of it makes that home improve and elevate my lifestyle and my living experience.
All right. Anything to add to that?
Phenomenal. It's well said. It's how we look at everything. Same idea. Just it's a holistic approach. And you got to show it all. You got to celebrate it all. It's well said.
So I know we've got some information here, but I think some of this is covered. What else would you add to this?
Mostly what I've said already, right? You're focusing on the value. You're not selling the price. One thing that bugs me more than anything else, so if I go into an electronics store like a Best Buy and I want to buy a TV, what's the first thing they're going to ask me? Anyone?
What price range?
What's your price range, right? If I go to a jewelry store and I want to buy a piece of jewelry for my wife, can I know the prices? They hide them. Why do they hide them? Because they're selling the value. The salespeople at Best Buy are doing Best Buy a huge disservice by starting with price, because now you're narrowing the conversation. I want to spend $800 on a TV. They're going to find the TV that's $800. What they should be asking me is, what am I looking for in a television? And then sell me on the value. If you start with price, you're telling the customer the most important thing is price. If you start with value, it makes it easier to justify the price later. Okay? Use relevant comparisons. I've heard, a lot, but for me, being an outsider, I'm just looking at it as, if I buy a used home, I have to pump money into it to get it not even to where it would be as a new home, just to get a few of the things I want. I have to put more money into it. Okay? If I buy a new home, I'm getting everything I want right off the bat. And then getting back to what Ryan said, rather than saying, here's the way we build, here's the product we've devised, now let's go sell it, it has to be customer centric. What is the customer looking for? Let's do that as much as is possible.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. So as we're kind of getting towards the end here, the last question is, what are some of the key messaging points we need to focus on when it comes specifically to resilience and integrity? So I think you had some first.
So I've done some research into insurance, some consumer behavior research. And what we are looking at specifically is, why do people buy insurance? What's some of the reasons? Now, as you all know, I'll lay it out for you anyway, because what I'm going to get to is a little counterintuitive. You get fire insurance, it doesn't stop a fire from damaging your home. What it does is give you money if that happens. But our research showed, when items were insured, people actually believed it was less likely that the harm would come to them. Okay. So we did a simple experiment. You were shipping a product across the country, and the shipping company offered you insurance, and whether you took it or not changed your perception of whether or not you thought that item would be damaged. So it almost was like a magic talisman. Having this insurance made you believe that it was safer. So being able to tell people it's fire reflective, you know, it withstands winds, all of that, you're not promising them the winds won't come. But an element of the way they're understanding that and internalizing that is, I am safer because I have this protecting me. So that's a big one. Sustainability, we've talked a lot about today. I'm not going to go into much more detail, but it does matter to a lot of customers. And to those customers to whom it matters, they are ready to pay more for that. And finally, personal health. So one story I told Brandon when we were preparing for this session. A few months ago, my daughter got sick with COVID. Now, my in-laws live near us. They're older. And one day, they had to come over and watch her because both my wife and I work. We needed to be outside of the house. My daughter had to wear a mask inside the house, right? Which is unpleasant for everyone involved. We didn't want to ask her to wear a mask. She didn't want to wear the mask, but we wanted to keep her grandparents safe and make sure that she was less likely to infect them. Imagine how much better we would have felt if we knew our home was built with a certain number of air exchanges per hour and we had that information, that the filtration system was specific for viruses like COVID. This is enormously important to customers right now at this moment. Will it be as important 2 years from now? God, I hope not. Okay, but right now it is extremely important. So being able to sell those health and wellness aspects to your home, that the air is clean enough that if someone decides, you know what, if I get sick, I'm just going to hang out in the basement for a couple of days and I don't have to worry about the air I'm breathing out in the basement infecting everyone above me without me having to walk around with a mask or go to a hotel, which is what a lot of people did during COVID or whatever else. That has tremendous value to customers. Even if no one ever gets COVID ever again, it's all top of mind for us right now. Okay? And whether it's COVID or whatever's going to come next, or air pollution or whatever else, this type of stuff is very important to customers. Even if, you know, they don't care as much about the sustainability side of it, they do want to make sure that the air they're breathing is healthy. And you can sell that.
It's a great teaser for this afternoon session on wellness and health. Let's get Mike's final comments on these key features, and then Ryan can wrap up.
If you're addressing it as a builder, if you're addressing the change in climate and the extreme heat and extreme weather, and the safer your home is built now, not just for earthquake or flood or wind, but if you're looking and you're building a better home, a truly new home, then you should be bragging about and showing them how it is safer, how it will be more resilient, and how it will resist the changes that we're facing. And again, it's not a political argument. It's not a discussion. It's just 8 billion of us on the planet versus 2 billion 120 years ago. And we're building homes and things are different. And so we're living in a different time. Is your home new enough to be different? And are you showing how it's going to be, give me peace of mind that it's at least as good as it can be? See, forget code. Code can be 4 or 5 years old. Is my home built to the latest and greatest standards? And can you brag about that and demonstrate that online and in the sales office?
Final thoughts?
Last thing I would just say for us is we avoid all polarizing kind of comments or points. We don't polarize anybody. We just have tools in our tool bag that if they want to polarize on us, then we can substantiate and show that, yep, if you're worried about climate, here's what we got for that. If you're worried about this, but we don't do the polarizing. There's just, people are just too volatile right now. Yeah. People are one side or the other, and we're not going to take a stance and be like, we're all about this. We just excluded a bunch of people. Or we're all, you know, one side or the other. We're not going to either side. We're Switzerland.
Well, on that note, and talk about polarizing at this particular moment in time, what you're talking about in terms of your green board and your dimensional product reminds me a little bit of Tesla. Okay, Tesla sold itself as a high technology car much more than it sold itself as an electric car. If you cared about emissions, fine, it's electric. but it was about performance and all the features and bells and whistles and everything. What you're talking about is this product performs better. It happens to be sustainable as well.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And if you care about that, we can sell the hell out of that part of it. But really, it's a better product.
Yep. That's what we say about our company, and that's what we should be saying about the new homes is we're a technology company. We just happen to deliver it through modular method.
Yep.
Yep. Two sides of the same coin. Customers want to buy. If we build and meet create that value that they're looking for, we can sell it for a higher price. So we'll wrap up for today. We'll see you at lunchtime. This is the contact information for everyone who's participated today. Join me in a round of applause for our panelists. Feel free to come up and talk to them. You're now excused to your next events. Make sure you check the back of your card where you're supposed to be next. Make sure you're there on time. And we'll see you at lunch. Thanks, everyone.